Liechtenstein really didn't make much of a mark during World War II, as you'd expect, but they could well have joined the Nazis. They were, after all, wedged between Nazi Germany, fascist Austria, and neutral Switzerland, so their fate could have been a lot different, especially after the Anschluss of Austria. In fact, Liechtenstein is a German-speaking nation, and should really have been a part of Germany when it united in the 19th century. But had Hitler looked to invade in the 20th century, it would have been a pretty easy conquest, as this tiny little country got rid of their armed forces a while back. Yet inside of Liechtenstein, a group of people wanted to bring the small principality into the Reich voluntarily. They formed their own far-right parties and tried to get the Germans to invade. Then, when this failed, they launched one of the most ridiculous coup attempts that the world has ever seen. But before we move on to the video, it's time for Raid Shadow Legends. Now, I know many of you will know this, but for those who don't, Raid Shadow Legends is a fantasy-themed, turn-based role-playing game. And let's just take a look at the team that I'm putting together. We've got Gaelic, who is undoubtedly the best for me. Sniper, who although is one of the higher levels, seems to be picked on by all opposition and is quickly killed. Then my ultimate favourite, Crusader, for obvious reasons. I've already decked him out with a lot of kit, but he still needs improving. But for me then, I think it's time to unlock another champion. And hopefully she's a little better. Anyway, as always, Raid is getting bigger and better every single month. For starters, they're releasing 11 new champions and up to 200 brand new missions to complete. You can also pick up an exclusive legendary champion as your reward if you manage to finish them all. What's more is they're also adding 5 tough new levels to almost every single dungeon in the game. Plus, also, once you're in-game, you can find me under the name Jabzy, and for the first people to join, you can even join in my clan and we'll go fighting together. So just click the link in the description, support this channel, and start summoning some awesome champions. So first, a little backstory. In the late 17th and early 18th century, the Counts of Hohenems went bankrupt, and they decided to sell their lordships of Schellenberg and Vaduz to House Liechtenstein. This house, by the way, took its name from the castle they owned outside of Vienna. So what would become the country of Liechtenstein was being governed by a lord who lived in Austria, and like many micronations today, at this point in history, it was an impoverished region. During the unification movement of the 19th century, Liechtenstein sided with Austria in the Austro-Prussian War of 1866, but its 81 soldiers they sent did not reach the front in time. Later on, they decided to join the German Confederation and the likes, but being so poor and isolated, it almost accidentally remained independent. Also, during all of this time, they were led by Johann II, one of the longest serving monarchs in the world. He ruled from the middle of the 19th century right up until the 1920s, so he saw Napoleon III rise to power at the beginning of his reign, and towards the end, he saw Mussolini come to power, so quite the extensive reign. He kept Liechtenstein close to Austria until the First World War, but the devastation of this war pushed them closer to Switzerland, and they even adopted their currency. But then in the 1930s, the Nazis came to power and almost instantly, two right-wing groups were founded in Liechtenstein, the Liechtenstein Homeland Service and the Nazi Party. Now combined, they only had around 300 to 400 members at any given time. But remember, this country only had around 13,000 people then, so this is still quite a large number. However, it should also be said that the Nazi Party in particular was chiefly the domain of German and Austrian emigrants, not necessarily the locals. The people of Liechtenstein were, after all, largely conservative, agrarian, and overwhelmingly Catholic. So this new Nazi ideology wasn't something that they all necessarily jumped in on. In fact, only around 5% of the population could be said to be Nazi or at least sympathised with their cause, as would be made abundantly clear during the failed putsch. The prince at the time, Franz Joseph, would also later say in an interview to the Times, "There is almost no Nazism in Liechtenstein. The population is content to live in a small, independent nation, and wishes to continue the close union with Switzerland." However, already in 1933, there was some tensions between the ruling government and the Nazis. This is because two Jewish businessmen known as the Rotter brothers fled to the country from Germany after the Nazis took power. However, the government of Liechtenstein refused to send them back to Germany. So a group of 9 people, including German emigrants and locals, tried to abduct them. But one of the brothers died while trying to escape by jumping out of the window. The would-be abductors were later imprisoned, and they made their allegiances clear with the graffiti they drew on the walls. Over time, as with many right-wing groups around the world, there were mergers and splits. For instance, in 1936, the Homeland Service joined with the Christian Social People's Party to form the Fatherland Union. Their leader was Alois Vogt, who had clear sympathies towards Hitler, but he would later enter into a coalition government, so keep his name in mind for later on. Plus, it should also be said that this Fatherland Front is still a political party, and is one of the two major political parties in the country. Further to the right, there was another Nazi group, the VDBL, which was created in 1938. Their name, translated, was the National German Movement in Liechtenstein, so they clearly had intentions to unite with Germany, and at its height, they had a few hundred members. This group was largely under the leadership of Dr. Alfons Kupp, and like Nazi movements elsewhere, they also had their own publication, known as Der Umbruch, which often wrote very anti-Semitic articles. But 1938 was a bit of a chaotic year in Liechtenstein. Well, as chaotic as you could expect in such a small place. Austria had, after all, just been annexed by the Germans, and the elderly monarch, Franz I, passed control over to Franz Josef II. In early 1939, Franz Josef II met with Hitler in Berlin, but what he hoped to achieve was a little ambiguous. Franz Josef had, after all, married a Jewish woman, something the Nazis within Liechtenstein clearly despised. Hitler, on the other hand, had very little to gain from Liechtenstein, but he did hate their new allies of Switzerland. Anybody who knows Hearts of Iron probably knows what he said about them. Switzerland possesses the most disgusting and miserable people and political system. The Swiss are the mortal enemies of the new Germany. This hatred of Switzerland will come from many things. For instance, they were home to many of the globalist organizations, like the League of Nations. Plus, Switzerland has also had a long history of direct democracy. Yet, as for Liechtenstein, no high-ranking Nazis ever had any real ambitions on the little country. Generally, the feeling was that Liechtenstein would just volunteer itself over to the Reich, and the British Foreign Office sort of went along with this. As they said, the prince is effectively under Hitler's thumb. So Hitler and the British felt that this would be inevitable, yet there's nothing to suggest that the prince would have done so. Anyway, at the beginning of 1939, there were German soldiers on Liechtenstein's borders, and the Nazis inside the country became emboldened by this. They made a move to take power in March 1939, when the prince was out of the country. This move for power came on the 13th, when the authorities discovered a number of swastikas were burnt, but they quickly discovered that they were in fact burnt by Theodor Schalder and Huber Koch. These were two prominent Nazi members, so we can guess that they were trying to bring the Germans into Liechtenstein through this act. Then, fortunately, we have written testimony and court documents describing the coup attempt itself. The coup began in the house of the painter Joseph Frick. A gathering of the members was taking place. When asked about the purpose of their meeting in front of the assembled people, Frick said that they would go to Vaduz tonight and demand the connection to Germany. After briefly inspecting the state of affairs in Scharn, I drove into the lowlands to the border to see whether there was anything disturbing going on. During this trip, I met the group from Unterland near the forest of Scharn. I asked a participant about the group's plans. They had heard that the leaders were locked up in Scharn, and that they would like to come to their aid as comrades. In addition, a sacrifice has to be made for the cause today, even if it was blood, so that the cause can get going. But they heard that their leaders had not been arrested, this was just a rumor, so many returned home. Others waited at the painter's house hoping for some news from Germany, but nothing came of it. The German troops at the border were just pulled back, and the whole thing began to fall apart. Then, in the elections the following month, the Fatherland Union just agreed to split power with Joseph Hoop's Progressive Citizen Party. Hoop had ruled Liechtenstein since 1928, yet the Fatherland Union was still happy to have a silent election, essentially one in which no one could vote in, and power would be split behind the scenes. So, even though Alois Vogt had sympathies towards Hitler, by doing this he could stop the Nazis from gaining any seats. Plus, as he was the new deputy prime minister, he had many of the Nazi leaders arrested afterwards. Then, this new coalition government got the people to sign a petition. The undersigned declare that they are standing on the foundation of self-reliance and independence of our home country, under the dynasty of Liechtenstein, and oppose any new direction in respect to our politics or economy. 95% of people agreed to sign it, but whether or not this shows their true beliefs is hard to say. But even though they stopped the Nazis from coming to power, Liechtenstein didn't act particularly nobly during the war. Only 230 Jewish people were allowed to settle there, and their companies continued to do business with the Nazis. House Liechtenstein also still held land in Austria, and they used forced labour on their properties and even bought Jewish land during the war. But had they done things differently, maybe the Nazis would have invaded. Plus, the Nazi publications like Der Umbruch was only banned in 1943, when Germany was being pushed back and it seemed unlikely that they would win the war. Then, at the end of the war, the anti-communist ruler allowed 400 Russians to settle in the country. These were Russians who had collaborated with the Germans against the Soviets, and at the end of the war, they more or less ran to Liechtenstein looking for refuge. On the way, they had picked up Grand Duke Vladimir Kirillovich, who was the head of the exiled Russian royal family. Hearing that Liechtenstein was giving these people refuge, the Soviets sent ambassadors to repatriate the men, and nearly half of them voluntarily agreed to do so, maybe feeling a little bit homesick, but they were never heard of again. The rest of them who remained survived, but they were later sent to Argentina, where they lived the rest of their lives. So, whereas all other nations repatriated Russians forcibly, like the British and French did, Liechtenstein was the only country that stood up to the Soviet Union. So, Liechtenstein didn't become a Nazi state, but there were similar coup attempts and movements around the world. And this is my question for you today. Do you know of any similar fascist or Nazi movements that nearly came to power during or before the war? For instance, one that comes to mind for me is the failed putsch on the 6th of February 1934 in France. Or there's also the Blue Shirts in China, and one of the strangest is Adrian Arcand, who declared himself to be the Führer of Canada. But if you know of any others, leave them in the comments below.